Chennai to Nagpur, what makes me to stand here is a common ideology, the common program by which the oppressed people of this country can be united and taken to a greater heights for the consistent progress of this country. And in that progress of the oppressed people, the teachings of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar guides us right from day one. Even the post of judge of the High Court, there are many ticklish issues concerning caste for which there are no precedents. In the only precedent we have is the teachings of Babasaheb Ambedkar, which guided us to render judgment true to the spirit of the Indian Constitution. And I always consider helped us to arrive at a correct position on matters which are caste related, which are sensitive, and which requires judiciary. To tell you a small example, as you all know that we have Anganwadi centers in many parts of India. In addition to that, we have in Tamil Nadu, the last 30 years, midday meal centers in attached to schools. And now nearly about 100,000 posts are there, 1 lakh posts are there for these centers, which are manned or which are managed by women employees. And curiously, both the state governments and central government has not taken a stand of bringing reservation to this post, saying they are part-time employment, central government or state government service. This was the argument which has been going on for several years, thereby very cleverly edging out the most oppressed people, namely the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe, from getting employment into this category. And therefore, when I became a judge, one very important question came, that in recruiting cooks for the centers, sometimes when Dalit cooks are appointed, they are not taken into employment by some of the school management, which are also very caste oriented, and therefore they refuse employment to Dalit cooks in these centers. And one such case came before me. In one school management, when the district collector sent a Dalit cook, the management said, "We will not have that lady inside." And the collector wrote to the management saying, "If you don't employ this particular person, then I'll close down the school." Then the school management came to the court saying that the collector cannot close the school only because we are saying no to a Dalit cook. This was a very ticklish question, because on the one hand, we can't close the school because the children will be, education will be affected. On the other hand, we cannot allow the management to exclude the Dalit cook from employment. Therefore, I passed an order that if the management do not employ this cook within a period of 15 days, then the collector can appoint a special officer to take over the school and run the school. The management was very afraid, and they took back this employee into the fold, and the school started functioning. This was one small example. Subsequently, another case came, because under these Anganwadi centers, the government wittingly, an employee must reside within 1 kilometer from the school premises. Now, in most of the villages, at least in our part of Tamil Nadu, the Dalit colonies are outside the village, and it is always 1 kilometer away from the village. So whoever drafted this rule did not think that they are indirectly perpetuating Dalit employees from entering into the employment. And therefore, one woman employee filed a case. I said, "You cannot have an inch tape jurisdiction based on residence." And therefore, I said, "This rule, this clause is an invalid clause, and it cannot be used. And if it is used, it will only block all the Dalit from entering into the school premises for this small employment." And thereafter, this is again another issue where indirectly government decided that unless we have a reservation in this employment, we cannot provide justice to a large section of the people. And therefore, I took the third case where the question was reservation. Now the central government and state government took the stand, there can't be reservation. For their stand was, it was a part-time employment. It is not a post, and it is only ad hoc employment. And therefore, the central government circular said that there is no reservation in Anganwadi centers. Now if this question is analyzed deeply, the idea being that the question of cooking a meal and serving to a large section, unwittingly or wittingly the governments have taken a stand not to allow Dalits. This was a state-sponsored untouchability. Therefore, in my judgment, I said it is not a mere question of empowering Dalit by giving an economic source of an employment. On the other hand, if a Dalit cook is employed and she cooks the food and serves it to the large number of children, then there is a case of a change of a stereotype, change of a role model, and therefore it takes the social harmony and the social cohesion into a larger section, and therefore the government obviously must make reservation, and therefore I pass an order in all these Anganwadi centers there must be a reservation for scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. I gave this judgment in July 2010, in April 2010, in all these centers, and thanks to this order and the government's follow up, we have 25,000 Dalit cooks cooking in this series of three cases, where the guiding force was that caste. As Dr. Babu Ambedkar said, that fundamental to all these issues is a caste prejudice, and therefore unless you annihilate caste, there is no question of social emancipation. And in that way I was fortunate to render all these three judgments, and which was accepted by the state government. And today in our state, at least, we have 25,000 Dalit women cooking food for children of all categories without there being any discrimination or caste prejudice. This is one aspect of our judicial role model in shaping what the things to come. But ultimately we find we are fighting for reservation in terms of 15, in terms of Article 16. We are fighting for promotion in terms of 16. But nevertheless, these are all only applicable to state sector. Unless it's a central government owned corporation, or a central government, or a state government, or a state government, central government sponsored societies where there is 100% aid, there is no question of reservation. Now what do we find? Increasingly, company after company, public sector after public sector are giving into private hands the employment to fight for a different kind of a right. How can we control private sector? Now you take any labor legislation, they are all intended as a social welfare legislation, and therefore it applies not only to government sector, it applies to private employees. And therefore it is not as if the constitution is preventing the government from enforcing a law which will provide for reservation in private employment. We'll have to sit together and work out the means by which we can make this demand as a constitutional demand. Very fortunately, when the right to compulsory and free education for children came in the year 2009-2010, the Supreme Court did not have any difficulty in upholding a 25% reservation for economically and socially poor children. In that judgment, Supreme Court upheld that we can uphold a parliamentary law which provides for reservation even in an unaided private institution. And therefore, a time has come, we must demand a reservation in private employment, without which our present Article 15 and 16 will remain only in a very small area, leaving out a larger section of the people from the purview of employment. My third point I want to emphasize is that ultimately the greatest danger we now face is the liberalization, privatization and the globalization. There are many people who think that this LPG brings a relief to these people, more particularly oppressed section. I beg to differ with that argument, because a privatization or a liberalization or a globalization indirectly is an assault on the people of this country, and the worst affected will be the common people. The people who are the oppressed people will be affected. Today you find the Walmart wants to come into the retail trade, the Reliance entered into the vegetable market, and these are all issues where the smaller, poorer people who have aching out living on a very, very small marginal profit are edged out from this process, thereby leading to a large section of this country being pauperized in this country. And therefore, our main enemy today is this danger, who is an unknown enemy, who is not visible, but who is very powerful, and whose tentacles are slowly crossing the Indian markets. And therefore, this is also part of our agenda, because by this privatization, the Indian industry, which we have built very hard, the Indian trade, which we have built very hard, will be completely diluted, thereby taking the country to a very grave economic threat. And lastly, I want to mention that ultimately, in your organization, which is very fortunate, that it is not just a backward class or SCST, it's also minorities who are the worst affected in the Indian constitutional framework, and therefore the unity of all the oppressed people can alone bring a greater change in this country, and I'm sure that's a will make appropriate schemes, programs and program of action which will bring a new change, a constitutional change, and usher in a new era for this country. Thank you.